Thank you for accepting this invitation for the interview.
Yeah, glad to be here.
It's a good work with this book in Bulgaria, and I hope that it will reach as many readers as possible. Let's go briefly through my questions. Our point is, security versus freedom. So what do you think? How much shall we compromise freedoms in the name of so-called security? Especially in the context of... Or actually, maybe you could comment whether this digital environment is shifting the border into one of these two directions, freedom or security.
Yeah, well, when I started writing this book in 2010, I actually thought that the border was shifting towards freedom, maybe even to a degree that would compromise security. But since then, I've come to see that the government in America is not only surveilling the internet more pervasively than ever before, but also going after leakers and whistleblowers more than ever before. 8 leakers have been prosecuted under the Obama administration who just gave information to the media, and they're treated as spies, literally prosecuted as spies. So I think that now I see the tools of WikiLeaks as a kind of necessary countermeasure to basically what's become a golden age of surveillance.
Okay, then... Again, speaking of cybersecurity, fighting terrorism, fighting child pornography, for example, my personal opinion is, maybe you could comment on that also, that the technology is always a step ahead, a step before the repressive institutions like police, like NSA in America, etc. Who will win that war?
Right. Well, it's really difficult to say. It's kind of a cat and mouse game. When you see that with the media... WikiLeaks scored a point, and then the government scored a point basically by putting all these leakers in prison, and then Snowden scored another point for the mice, essentially. So I think that something similar happens in every one of these battles. I've been writing a lot lately about the online black market for drugs, which use a lot of the same cryptography and anonymity tools to protect drug dealers online. If there's a site called the Silk Road that Americans are now using to buy any drug imaginable with total privacy. And I think it probably is a matter of time until there's a government crackdown on that, but then there'll be a new technology that enables it in a different way. So these things go back and forth, and I don't think that anybody ever wins the battle. It goes on forever.
So you wouldn't say that we're doomed to lose that battle?
No, if you... looking at the drug market, for instance, it's clear that that's a step ahead of the authorities. I think that you can say the same thing about investigative media. Sometimes, Snowden was also ahead of the authorities. He used encryption to safely get his materials to a few journalists, and it wasn't intercepted, and he wasn't caught before he successfully left the country and achieved asylum. So, I don't think that the cats always win either.
Next question is about, it's a European concept, but I do believe that in America you have the similar ideas. Transparent government versus non-transparent citizens, which means, our digital and offline privacy should be protected in some way, contrary to the government, which should be as transparent as possible. So what's your input, comment on that?
Well, it seems pretty clear that the NSA would like to be untransparent and make the lives of foreigners, and to a lesser extent Americans, entirely transparent to them. So, it's good to see that this leaks from Snowden have created more awareness of this, and that there is a call for NSA transparency, transparency of the surveillance state, someone to watch the watchers. I think that is really important, and I think it's coming in small steps in America.
My question was more related to the way the government operates, all the interactions, all the financial, whatever, tradings and all, the whole... What is the proper balance? How much it should be transparent in its, official dealings with it?
Right. Well, it's difficult to say. I think that the excuse of national security is used to overclassify hugely. Probably, who knows within the giant growing mass of classified information, what of it actually needs to be secret versus what's just embarrassing. Mm-hmm. And I think that the part of it that's just embarrassing, or just reveals some kind of waste or fraud, is actually much larger than we imagine. But the thing about whistleblowers is that they have the power to seek out the important things that should be exposed, and not the things that would endanger people. I mean, whistleblowers are ethical by definition, and I think Julian Assange understood that, that this is the way to not reveal everything, but reveal the things that need to be revealed. So, you know, it is a tough balance, but leaking is a powerful tool for separating what needs to be known versus what needs to be secret.
Speaking of whistleblowers, would you put, you know, that kind of journalism, that kind of exposing the truth within the left and right political scheme? Is it left?
Oh,
you said
no,
that you're called
not.
Digital Bolshevik or?
Right, yeah. Well, somebody called me in the comments of one of my stories, called me a techno-Bolshevik.
Techno, sorry.
But I don't think that's true. I mean, I don't feel like I take a left or a right side on this. And the internet is like a new kind of world where left and right sort of disagree and agree on totally different things. You know, the when in America this bill SOPA was created, that you know, was a danger to internet
SOPA
freedom
people.
In a lot of ways. Right, yeah, exactly. It cut across the left and the right in terms of both who supported it and who fought against it. And I think this kind of internet libertarianism almost deserves a new political party, you know.
Okay, thank you. Two more questions. We speak of technology nowadays. You speak about Tor, etc. But technology advances. Is there any guarantee that after, say, 10 years or something, the WikiLeaks informers, they won't be exposed publicly?
Yeah, well, you know, it's true that cryptography is always a battle of keeping secret information secret for some period of time, you know. But I think that the thing about Tor is that to actually break it, as far as I understand, you have to collect a massive amount of information. Basically, you have to surveil the entire internet, because the thing is that if the leaker is anonymous, then the surveillance doesn't know where to begin. You know, if you could see the entire network, then you can break Tor. That's known. Mm-hmm. But if you don't, then it's like a giant haystack full of needles that look like pieces of hay. You know, it's like there's no way to differentiate what is the target. It's not just like we need to break into this box and we can do it if we just spend 10 years on it. You know, the NSA doesn't know where to begin.
Last question is about the copyright policies and intellectual property protection laws, etc., which are, I would say, outdated, back to 19th century, for example.
Yeah.
How does the internet changes, you know, the market landscape and, you know, the show business, etc., in that terms, protecting copyrights, protecting intellectual property, etc.?
Yeah. Well, the cypherpunks like to say that the internet basically, it doesn't have to deal with the law, it makes its own laws in code. If you look at BitTorrent didn't defeat copyright law, it just went around it. You know, like, it interprets censorship as damage and routes around it. That's what John Gilmore, who's a cypherpunk, said, and that's absolutely true about piracy. The thing is that I actually don't believe that SOPA would have even worked to prevent piracy if it had been implemented. It would have done damage to the internet, but in fact, you know, that kind of trying to control extremely leakable shared secrets, it will never work. So it doesn't really matter what the laws are. I think that piracy and copyright infringement is going to continue, and it's best to adapt your corporate policy or your government policy to live in that world.
What is the future of a politician in America who has a file as our file, Buddha file, Bulgarian Buddha file, Prime Minister, former Prime Minister?
You mean if there was an American...
Yes, if there is an American politician who has the same file as Bulgarian Prime Minister.
Yeah. Well, I have to think that in America that actually that person would be investigated and prosecuted. You know, maybe I'm naive, but I think that we live in a democracy that has more accountability for politicians. And we do sometimes see politicians go to jail. And we, in our Watergates, Nixon... Well, it's true, he was pardoned. So maybe I'm wrong. But, you know, he's been seen as a criminal and he resigns immediately. And it was, and really solely as a result of Watergate. Whereas here, you know, the first leak from BalkanLeaks that essentially showed evidence that Borisov was a criminal had no effect. You know, so I guess I have more hope for America. Forgive me for being nationalistic, but I think that, you know, our democracy does t- tend to punish politicians who are proven to be criminals more than in Bulgaria.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, thank you for the conversation. Thank you. Maybe you could sign the book.